this because I have no part in it. And I don't even like listening to it because it's not, and he was shocked because he thought that was going to be who, you know, boy, she's really going to want to talk about this. And I said, no, 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 no. He really didn't understand how come I didn't want to be involved in that. And I said, don't you see what's happening here? They're creating just the opposite of the problem they started out with.
And creating just a stronger problem doing it. Maybe even stronger.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I agree. I understand exactly what you're saying.
Yeah. Yes. You got the woman's movement, and then you got the man's movement called macho.
Yeah. Well, they're both pretty bad.
They are both equally as bad.
Yeah.
And you get those two pendulums in the same arc, exactly opposite each other. Boy, I tell you, it creates sparks when it hits.
Well, what I try to do with the people that I work with is I try to teach them how to be human. Not male, not female, be human. Be a human being. You know, if you can go inside yourself and touch that humanness, that makes magic in a relationship, you know, that you have that mutual respect, that understanding for the other person, that honesty, all of that humanness.
Yeah, and you got to learn somebody might be hard as a rock in a position. And maybe wrong, but hard as a rock in it. And you've got to learn how to grow the vine in a loving way around the rock.
Right.
You know, the flower can break a stone. And but if you go at it with a sledgehammer, you break the stone all right. But boy, there's going to be pieces flying all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
It's a gentle breaking or violent breaking. And a flower is love, and a stone is pride, self-preservation, whatever. And love can hollow up that stone and simply spread it apart until on its own it cracks. And it's really something. I talk to a lot of women and men, please, maybe as much men as women on sexual needs. All right? I do a lot of counseling as a Wiccan. A holy man, a counselor, a spiritual counselor. And I'm kind of crude. I don't pull punches, and shoot, I am what I am. Take me the way I am, or move aside. You know, I'm not going to hate you for not liking me. I'll pray for you, and frankly, I'm kind of getting off the subject. You don't like me. It's probably because I deserve not being liked. You know, really. But nevertheless. You know, I watch these young girls, especially the really young girls, 10 and 11, you know, hopping in bed with these little macho dongs. That's all, you know, walking dongs. And then you get the moms doing it. So it's disgusting. Can I say that I'm holy and all that jazz? Yeah. But I haven't been, you know. I've had my heyday. I was a stupid kid too. And I realized that in the macho movement, I tell them all, if you're going to make love to a woman without an actual commitment, hopefully a life commitment, you know, if you're playing a Texan with the gun in your holster and you pull that gun out and get a shot now and then, I would like to see these outlaws, you know, these brave macho outlaws, notch their dong every time they do it. And I tell you, they're going to quit doing it. The real bad guys used to notch their guns when they'd shoot somebody. Well, if you're going to do it that way, notch it. And anybody that's got more than one notch is crazy. A woman shouldn't want him, you know. But it would be kind of nice, you know. Notch the dang gun and realize that that thing in your pants, guys, is a holy thing for a holy use. And I'm speaking God holy, all right? And you should respect the opposite sex. It's easy for me to say, no, I'm older, I'm wiser. And I know what it's like to be young and horny. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I don't know. I wish there was some way that that people would grow up, adults and children alike, in their spiritual fact that they are a walking temple, a walking holy thing, and then respect themselves and respect others. And boy, it would sure make a lot of difference. It's no problem for me to call brother and sister to anybody with that kind of an attitude. And I've done it for many, many years, you know, before I was an old beady-eyed, bald, toothless idiot like I am. I could see by calling someone brother or sister, and particularly in the female end of it, that's exactly what I got. Do I want to hop in bed with my sister? If she is my sister, she is my sister. That's it. And just by recognizing that we come from the same Creator's womb, the brain of the Creator, we are brothers and sisters. Some are better looking than others and all that jazz. But it should be a holy relationship, period. We look at people as brothers and sisters, family, and then gain the love that family should have for each other, and hand-holding spine and kissing spine, and then petting starting to get you into some trouble, you know. But find a holiness, a balance, a respect for each other, females to the males to the females. I don't know if that will ever come about. I know it won't in my lifetime, but maybe someday.
Well, I have some one young client in particular, in her early 20s, mid-20s, and she was raised in a family. I actually work with many generations in this family. I have grandma, I have ma, I have now, you know, the granddaughter, and she's out in Hollywood, you know, she's in the entertainment industry, she's in the midst of probably the most falseness you're going to find in this country. And she wants to be there because she believes that she can make a difference. She really believes that she can begin to create some change from that. Because the media, if you can actually get in there and do something, they're reaching huge numbers of people. You've got an opportunity, whether or not it's going to work. But I've been working with her a lot. And it's really interesting because she said, people want to know, what am I taking drugs? Because I am so happy in the way that I pursue life. She said, I pursue my career the same way that I'm looking at a relationship. And she said, for the first time in my life, I realized that you have to be true to yourself. You have to tell the truth. You can't play games. You can't manipulate people. You can't live your life in a way where you're trying to control people. You want them to do for you. You know, you've got to just get out there. And if you're going to lose somebody because you're telling them the truth, you don't want them in your life.
That person wasn't worth it.
That you don't want that. She said, I'm now realizing that the relationships that I've had in the past made me unhappy because I couldn't be myself. And now I want to be myself, and I want somebody who wants me to be myself. And so she's just really happy with this. And everybody keeps coming up to her and asking her, are you on, like, drugs or something? I mean, you're just so, there's something. She said, now, don't get me wrong. It's hard work. It's hard work being honest, telling yourself the truth. And every time you want to go over here, go, uh-uh. Wait a minute, that's not the truth. You just lied to yourself again. Because you get so conditioned. And she's brought up in a family that encourages her to lie. They encourage her to play games and never tell the truth and manipulate and, you know, control and all that. So when she calls home to talk to mom about what's going on in her life, mom's going, why would you do that? You never tell anybody the truth. You never do this. You never do. You'll never get anywhere. You know, so she doesn't get reinforcement from home to be herself. That's, you know, she's got nowhere to go. So I've been doing a lot of counseling with her on the phone, and she's just really come out. I mean, I was quite surprised.